Welcome to step two. In step one, we have looked at a mismatch between our genes and our modern environment as the fundamental cause of our unhealthy aging patterns. In this step two, we're going to look at the way the current medical system approaches the age-related diseases and symptoms that are a consequence of this mismatch. And we will also discuss an alternative approach. Before we start, I want to share my view on the aging process with you. I've come to look at the aging process as an emergency in slow motion. But let me explain what I mean by that. I was trained as a medical doctor. And as a medical doctor, you learn how to deal with emergencies. Two cars crash, casualties, broken bones, blood. If you follow some of the TV series on hospitals, you might believe that 90% of the work of doctors is emergencies. The other 10% is chasing the nurses and doing all the fun stuff at the hospital. When I finished my medical training and I was in medical practice, I saw very few emergencies. What I found was mostly older people with all sorts of chronic complaints, complex health issues. One day, however, I realized that these are emergencies too. A heart attack is just as deadly as two cars crashing. The only thing that is different is that cars crash in 20 seconds and a heart attack takes 20 years to develop from the first damage to the fatal blow. They are emergencies in slow motion. And as a doctor, it frustrated me that patients would always come just after the crash. Oh, doctor, pain on my chest, and then I would diagnose a heart attack, send them to the hospital quickly, but I would always have the feeling that I was just too late. With aging, there are 20 years between the onset of the accumulation of damage and the resulting emergency. 20 years is a long time to steer away. But how do we steer away? How do we prevent age-related diseases? Let's take the analogy from the car industry a bit further. In the past, cars were not very safe. And in the first attempt to make cars safer, the industry made them stronger, more robust. They included a crumple zone to absorb the energy of the impact, and cage constructions and seat belts to make sure that you would come out of an accident in one piece. This was a great improvement. They started from the assumption that everyone was at risk of an accident at some point and did what they could to get you out of this accident alive. This is much like the way medicine still works. They wait until you get a heart attack, an accident, and then they rush out and try to get you out alive. Ambulances are on the scene within 20 minutes, highly trained staff, onboard EKG machines. Within an hour, whole teams are ready to remove the clot with coronary intervention and place stents through a small wire they insert in the leg. Let me be clear. This is a great success of medicine. Cardiovascular mortality has seen a spectacular drop of over 60% in the last decades. If you have a heart attack and manage to make it to the hospital alive, you nowadays have 99% chance to also leave the hospital alive. But the car industry has already moved forward. They are now trying to prevent the accident with sensors that detect cars around you. Cars that automatically brake if a car in front of you suddenly stops. Some cars even steer away from impeding impacts. The car industry is now trying to prevent the accident. And that is exactly the path that medicine should take. We have become much better at making people better when they are sick. But now it's time that we become much better at keeping people healthy. And the truth is, we are still very bad at that. The problem is partly a problem of mindset. For most medical doctors, when they think of all the patients, palliation is more on their mind than prevention. Even though most diseases of old age are diseases that can be influenced by lifestyle, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, osteoporosis, etc. Nowadays, if you visit your general practitioner, he will ask you what's wrong. If you say there's nothing wrong, he will tell you to come back when something is wrong. Instead, although there's no immediate accident, there are things wrong in most of us. One in four patients who still smoke, the GP should be alarmed and react as if he witnesses an accident that is about to happen. Two cars that are on a collision course. He should warn them how their smoking is leading to serious accidents in later life. He should tell over half of his patients about how inactivity and overweight are increasing their risk of arthritis, diabetes, gastric complaints, and many more age-related problems. He should warn 9 out of 10 patients that their current diet is lacking vegetables and fibers and is too high in calories, and will cause obstipation, bowel symptoms, diabetes, and many other complaints. In this step, we will look at various common age-related diseases and symptoms and how medicine currently approaches them and consider some alternatives. What do lifestyle changes have to offer to prevent or treat some of these age-related diseases? And how do their effects compare quantitatively to some of the pills that doctors now prescribe? Does reducing your coffee intake lower your blood pressure? And how much? And what about salt? And how large are these effects compared to the regular treatment, the pills your doctor gives you?